WynnBET, the official sports book partner of the Memphis Grizzlies, is Tennessee's premier digital sports betting app. They're bringing you the action of real money sports betting right in the palm of your hand with some of the best odds in the game. From boosted parlays to live in-game odds on every major sport, they have what you need to win. Sign up today and use the promo code Grizz. And after placing your first $10 wager, you'll receive $200 to bet with. That's G-R-I-Z-Z. There's no better way to enjoy basketball than with some extra winnings in your pocket to use for all of your favorite bets. And be sure to check out the WynnBET Sports Bar at FedEx Forum the next time you catch our Grizzlies in action. Betting is a team sport. Join the WynnBET team and bet with the best. Must be physically located in Tennessee and 21 years of age or older to participate. If you or someone you know needs assistance with a gambling problem, call the Tennessee Red Line at 1-800-889-9789.
Lieutenant, can you tell us what happened today?
Our officers responded to a crash on I-40 westbound this morning. The driver of a pickup truck lost control of the vehicle, veered left, and went into a ditch.
911, what's your emergency?
We've been in a crash. Please send someone. My fiancé is hurt.
A front seat passenger was wearing a seatbelt. She survived without injury. The driver was not wearing a seatbelt and was ejected from the truck. He died at the scene.
Law enforcement writes tickets to save lives. Brought to you by the Tennessee Highway Safety Office.
Don't miss a minute of Grizzlies basketball down the stretch with Bally Sports Southeast. Watch on UVerse, channel 1727, DirecTV channel 649-2, and Xfinity channel 1251. Or stream it live on the Bally Sports app. And for real-time Grizzlies news and updates, follow at Grizz on Bally on Twitter. Bally Sports Southeast, home of your Memphis Grizzlies.
Represent every day, presented by Delta Dental of Tennessee, is an incentive-based program focused on keeping youth K through 6th grade engaged in school in order to combat truancy. In partnership with Shelby County Schools and with the help of Delta Dental of Tennessee, the Grizzlies are focused on reducing chronic absenteeism among the most impacted schools in the Mid-South. Students in the program have the opportunity to win fun and unique prizes by going to school every day and being engaged in the classroom. For more information on the program, visit grizzlies.com/community/education today.
It's official. The Memphis Grizzlies are in the NBA playoffs and they're looking to go all the way. There's nothing quite like experiencing Grizzlies basketball live. And you can be there to cheer them on during the most exciting time of the year. As the official marketplace of the Memphis Grizzlies, Ticketmaster gets you into the 2022 NBA playoffs with a huge selection of seats. So get off the couch and into the stands to cheer on your Grizzlies as they go for the championship. Score tickets today at Ticketmaster.com.
LifeCare Ambulance is proud to be an official partner of the Memphis Grizzlies and FedEx Forum. At LifeCare, they wear their hearts with pride. Their passion is their people. They want you to love what you do and where you do it. Their employee-driven culture encourages a healthy work-life balance and supportive work environment. They invest in your success and well-being so that you can provide the best care for the patients that they serve. Join the incredible team of EMTs and paramedics in Memphis, Nashville, and across the nation today. Learn more at lifecareamb.com.
Here are your two big deal cheeseburgers. Enjoy your Sonic.
I love the sauce, don't you? So it's not just ranch. It's got a little zing to it.
Yeah, like a dilly ranch. Don't dilly-dally with this. Get to Sonic.
Don't dilly-dally. Run.
The ultimate burger for pickle lovers is here. The Sonic Big Dill Cheeseburger, topped with crispy pickle fries, crinkle-cut pickles, and creamy dilly ranch. Try one for half price when you order online or in the app for a limited time at Sonic. Exclusions apply. See app for details. Limited time only at participating Sonic drive-ins.
Hear that? That's the plumpest, juiciest hot dogs you've ever seen getting their grill on.
But we both know what'll make it sound even better.
Oh yeah, it's a Pepsi to go with your hot dog. Because when you're chomping on America's favorite meal, relish, mustard, and onions perfectly blending into a crescendo of flavor, there's only one thing that makes everything about that moment better. A cold, refreshing Pepsi. See what I mean? It's like music to my ears. Hot dogs. Better with Pepsi. That's what I like.
Live from FedEx Forum, this is the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com. Presented by WynnBET. Now, here's your host, Chris Vernon.
GrindCityMedia.com. It's Chris Vernon Show. Welcome, 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 welcome. It is the Monday, May 16th, 2022 edition of the show. Today on the show, we'll have 10 things from the weekend. The Grizzly season ended since we last spoke, and they have already had media day to close out the season as they head off for the summer. We'll go through that. We'll go through the basketball games that took place over the weekend. We'll get to all the news and notes. It's a Monday smile. Let's do it. Turn it up! Having a good day. All right, we got a ton of things to get to. It was a very busy weekend, and as I mentioned, there was a year-end media session that took place yesterday with the Grizzlies, where everybody spoke, including the general manager, Zach Kleiman, as the season came to the end on Friday night with a loss against the Golden State Warriors in Game 6. And it's kind of odd when it happens on a Friday night because now we come back to work and, you know, you just spend from October all the way until May where it's the focus. You're going to games 2-3 times a week sometimes. And even when they are on the road, you're talking about games constantly. And then it all just ends. And you wake up the next day, and it felt kind of weird because it was a weekend, right? Because we would typically be here talking about what took place. And on Friday night, I did the Bally post game along with Pete Pranica and Rob Fisher, and it was late, late. And honestly, that's a long show that we were doing. It's like an hour long. And so, you know, you're kind of talking through the game at the beginning, and then, of course, the last whole segment – we're talking about kind of the season, and they're playing all these highlights, and you're just like, it all comes rushing back like really quickly. And like, there were so many times where they were playing like highlight packages, and they played a John Morant highlight package, and they played, you know, different moments from the season. And it's just, it's so hard to take it all in right at one time, because as some of those are playing, I'm like, I totally, like, forgot about that. Everything just because, you know, your memory just gets clogged up with everything that's taken over the course of the past, like, 2-3 weeks, and especially playoffs because it's just so heightened. But when the John Morant package starts with a dunk and then this crazy block, and it's Cleveland, which was the first game of the season, and then like the two-handed block at the Lakers, I totally forgotten. Like, there's so many plays that took place, there's so many moments that took place that you end up forgetting about a lot of things that took place. But, you know, look, I ended the show on Friday night, and I said, if you would have told me at the beginning of the season that the Grizzly season is going to end in a Game 6 on the road in the Western Conference semifinals against the Golden State Warriors, I would have signed up for that 1,000 times out of 1,000. If you would have just told me they're going to be in the playoffs, I would have signed up for that. That's all I want. I want to have a chance, right? And I wanted to be the 7 or 8. You know, I wanted to have the advantage going into a play-in situation, because when we were writing it out at the beginning of the year, there were 6 that were like for sures, probably. 6 that were for sures that were, okay, they should absolutely be better than the Grizzlies, and that's okay. Instead, they ended the season 2nd. It was all a dream, and like,
They ended up in the second round of the playoffs, and they lost to the Golden State Warriors on the road, and they were up 2 with less than 7 minutes left to go. So they played it out. They went out on their shield. Some teams did not exactly go out on their shield as they head to the postseason, and head to the offseason. It makes the offseason, honestly, like, you end up feeling good about it. You know, it stinks and in the moment to lose, but then all in all, you feel good about it. And I think certainly as everybody heard what guys had to say at the media session yesterday, you feel even better, I think, about it. Because certainly they took the city over. There's no way around that. And it was a great, great season. We'll chronicle that and a lot of other stuff and the stuff that took place yesterday. Before I get to anything, I welcome John Roser to the show. John Roser, a.k.a. the Cologne Ranger, the Body Spray Bandit, Senior Sack, a.k.a. John the Backbone Thunder Bearcat, a.k.a. the Grim Roser, John Hustle, Johnny Spirkus, Johnny Neckarb, a.k.a. John Kep. What up?
What up, what up, what up, what up, what up?
Devin Walker's here. He is the microphone mangler, Senor Quasadilla, Mr. Math, Navajo Joe. He is the
reporter.
Yeah, shout out to everybody who said I was covering my face on that video, bro. I just don't want everybody to see you, man. Like, you know what I'm saying? No face, no case, dog. You feel me?
What are you talking about?
You feel me?
I don't know.
You don't feel me?
I have no.
I feel you.
You feel me? All right, bet.
Kelsey Wright Johnson's here.
She is
Brampton's finest. She is the ketchup chip connoisseur. She is Puerto Rico's favorite reporter.
Big time.
All right, we got a lot of stuff to get to, and you know what we're going to start with, so let's just go ahead and get to 10 things.
Let's do
ten things. Number one. All right, the Grizzlies season came to an end in San Francisco on Friday night. So I came up here to watch the game, and as I mentioned, we did that post-game show on Bally Sports. It was kind of nip-tuck, you know, got to halftime. I felt okay about it. Third quarter, I'm like, yo, just stick around. And they were. And then it got to the fourth quarter, stick around. And you're going to give yourself a chance. And then, of course, like the last 6-7 minutes, it just went all wrong. And next thing you know, the Warriors win by probably a bigger margin than what would indicate the competition level in that game. They just kind of exploded.
It piled on at the end.
Yeah.
The Grizzlies fell apart a little bit. I mean, they did. They started playing one-on-one basketball.
Look at Rosa talking to the wall.
Talking to the wall? Yeah, it was. It went all wrong the last 6-7 minutes, and that was a veteran team. They took good shots, they got good shots, and more importantly, they beat the Grizzlies at their own game, which was the extra possessions making you pay for those extra possessions.
Freaking Kayvon Looney, man.
Brilliant move by...
It was awesome.
Draymond Green.
Steph Curry and Draymond Green, evidently. Yeah, not Mike Brown.
Don't give Mike Brown credit for that.
It really did change things dramatically. Because I know Adams got a little hobbled, but even without Adams hobbled, like, he became a real advantage. What was a real advantage for the Warriors at the beginning of that series then flipped, and it became the Grizzlies, who in Game 5 had taken 18 more shots than the Warriors in the first half blowout. And so now they put Looney back in the lineup, and it changed things dramatically, and you got to give him credit. It's kind of crazy because we're probably not even going to see him in the next round. No. But for that one moment in time when they needed him, I thought he completely changed that game for them. And they had some guys step up. Klay Thompson turned back the clock
Game six, Klay, man.
Andrew Wiggins had some big plays. And let me just say something, all right? Like, I have never seen
anything like the reaction to Andrew Wiggins doing good things. He makes $32 million a year and started the All-Star game. And when he makes minor contributions to winning, it's like they pulled a kid off the street and put him. It's like Austin Reeves. It's like, you know, ooh, Austin Reeves coming up big when they need. Like, he makes $32 million and started the All-Star game. Like, why is anybody so shocked?
He was the number one pick in the NBA draft.
Yeah.
Because he sucks.
And it's like,
he was a McDonald's All-American. He was the number one high school player in the country. He was the number one pick in the NBA draft.
He has a 10-year Adidas deal, but he wears Kobe's.
I mean, sorry to your Canadian brethren, Kelsey. All right. You were in the arena.
Yeah.
At what point did the "everything is fine, Devin" escape your body?
When Steph started hitting a couple. Actually, I will say, when I started freaking out, when Dylan got hot in the fourth quarter a little bit, when Dylan came off that curl and the ball bounced off his leg and Andrew Wiggins went and dunked it, or...
There was a turning point. It was the three and the Wiggins.
I was like, bro, no.
The Wiggins three, the Wiggins get the steal and the run out.
It was that 5 points in a row.
But then Wiggins got the next rebound, came down, handed it off to Curry, who buried a three. It was eight. Like, it was like a 2-point game, and then it was boom.
I closed my computer. I was like, I'm done. I was freaking out. I was like, bro, if I'm going to have death by Andrew Wiggins, then this is not going to be a fun time. But I think it was... Crowd sucked too, by the way. Somebody was like, yo, it sounded good on TV. Dude, Chase Center crowd sucks.
It is not Roracle.
It's not Roracle. I would say probably like when Steph hit that corner tray ball, that's when I was like, yeah.
It's like a wrap. You legitimately were like,
yeah, when he did that, when he was like, yeah, I was like, yeah. Because it was actually kind of loud when he hit that. And I was like, yeah.
Throughout the series and throughout the playoffs, for that matter, I talked about being a victim of your own success and where you move on the dry erase board. And so if you are Desmond Bane and you kill it in Minnesota, well, then you're going to come into the next series and they're going to make sure that you're not a problem for them. And the same thing went with Brandon Clark. Brandon Clark's not going to get to sneak up on anybody anymore, right? And I'll give you another one. You saw what they were doing with Tyus. They started treating Tyus like a different animal. Andrew Wiggins is out there on him. Like, they're guarding him full with court. The big wing, and they're picking him up. And it's like,
he didn't have 21 again.
Because he was so awesome, right? He's 21-9 with no turnovers. And he was just – and so you do become a victim of own success. And that can go from game to game. And that can also go from series to series. But honestly, like – I don't know, man. It was disappointing for sure. Watching Kevon Looney grab every rebound and then them making you pay for it.
Yeah.
The
offensive rebounds. And oh, look, I told Fish, I was like, I don't know if I have ever seen 70 on a. I can't remember seeing 70 on a box score for rebounds.
Yeah.
Like, that means, I mean, you just have to get so many of your own misses and the other team's misses. Yeah. And I covered Grizzlies teams that were just freakish at offensive rebounding. But 70 is so extreme.
And we only had, what, 40, 44? Yeah, that was dominant on the board.
70 to 44.
70 rebounds.
I mean, the Grizzlies did shoot 35%, so there was rebounds to be had.
You know, and I know Jaren struggled. There was never a time in the game where I was like, what are you shooting? And I know, I don't think he took bad shots. They didn't drop for him. Brandon Clark, he took all the same shots he always takes.
He couldn't get a bounce.
Which is so unlikely.
Jones, floaters, would go in.
Brandon threw on the rebound thing.
Huh?
Most rebounds from our PR staff. Most rebounds a team has allowed in a playoff game in the last 39 years.
In 39 years? Whoa,
Brandon!
So
had
what
a,
you said you've never
yes,
seen?
Yes, yeah, that's the reason why you've never seen that.
You were right.
70's a ton, man. That's like a ton.
The reason why you've never seen that.
39 years. Most what?
23rd most rebounds in any NBA game. 70 is the most rebounds in a game this whole NBA season.
So you know what?
So it's top 25 ever.
I think it's fair to say I probably I'd have to go back and look at the other 22, but I bet I haven't been a part of them. You know what I mean? So the idea that it probably was the only time I've ever seen that in a box score,
I will say,
is legitimate.
Yeah,
I would probably say one of the what's going to be interesting when you do go look at them is you're probably going to find that like Wilt Chamberlain probably had 70 rebounds one game by himself.
Yeah. Fake news. That didn't happen. Hey, by the way, too, I forgot to mention, they tried to do the whoop that trick thing to us.
I heard
it. Did you hear it through the TV?
Yeah, it was pathetic.
Okay, good.
It was sad.
I'm glad it sounded pathetic.
It was sad.
It was like, what the heck? Like, people in front of me were doing it, and like people were like trying to get each other to do it. The guy was like this in the crowd, like doing this.
Couldn't do it.
I gotta say, if the crowd did it loud, I would have given it to them.
They tried.
But a pathetic effort.
Yep.
They tried it.
I'm going to defend them a little bit because it is San Francisco. A lot of Silicon Valley people there. Probably a little bit upset that the crypto stocks are tanking right now for them. Probably losing a lot of money right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Distracted by the Bitcoin dropping so much.
Nervous to breathe on each other.
Yeah.
Different world. Different world out there.
Different world. No culture world. Saltine cracker ass crowd. My bad. Keep going.
That's racist.
No, it's not. It's an unseasoned
That's
crowd.
That's racist.
They're trying to steal our swag.
Everybody tries to steal our swag, man.
Yeah. They try to get a rap group before my halftime.
That you didn't know. You should at least bring out Too Short.
E-40 was at the game.
Yeah. Shout out to E-40.
He was front row.
Bang Bang Niner Gang.
He gave him the microphone. He told him when to go. But you got this random rap group because you want to be Memphis so bad.
That's tough.
Y'all can't be
That's
us.
That's tough.
But yeah, continue about the game.
All right. So anyway,
they could have gotten Dame Dalla. He ain't doing anything.
Roser.
Hold on. Yeah. Simmer down. Yo. No, bro. Chill.
He's from the area.
He's from Oakland, bro.
Wait, it's the Bay.
Strays.
Yo, it's the Bay.
Wait, what did Dame do to you, bro?
Bang, bang. Strays.
Can you actually imagine if Dame Dalla performed at halftime of
All-Star game?
We saw him perform at halftime of the All-Star game.
There's like a little connection.
My goodness, it was NyQuil.
Yeah.
Stop.
Yeah.
Y'all not for the slander.
It was.
You saw the difference because we saw.
I love him as a performer on the basketball court.
Yeah.
Y'all messed up.
Because we saw the next night Chance performed at halftime of the All-Star game. And when you looked at Dame's performance and Chance, you see which one is an actual.
What do you mean? Chance was terrible too.
Chance was not terrible.
No.
He was not terrible.
Chance's brother was terrible.
Yes.
I would be like, they're like, Chance the Rapper's brother. Why does he get to perform?
It's the John Stamos, his brother, South Park.
Yeah. It's Chance the Rapper's brother. We're like, what is he doing out here? Yeah. Get him off. Get him out of here. They're just letting anybody. Is it open mic night?
They just letting anybody.
Oh, man.
Anyways, look.
Shout out Dame Dalla.
This is, I posted after the game. These are the scars. We talk about this. Everybody loses before they win. You don't want to have to lose, but that's the truth of the matter. That's how you develop the scars, and that's how you get to the next level. Because the next time around, you know, it's 48 minutes, and you see these teams that have some championship medal, and the ones that get it done are the ones that are able to maintain that focus, that execution, that tenacity, all the way to the very end, right? It's a different level, and it even raises a level when you get to winning time in elimination games. And the truth of the matter is, the Grizzlies are a young team that, you know, that's a time through, and you're playing on the road against a team that, you know, they get in there. Those guys went to 5 finals.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? This ain't their first, second, third, 10th rodeo. You know, they went through it over and over and over again. And once upon a time, they were getting knocked out, right? They pushed San Antonio when they're very young, right? But, like, that's the way it goes, right? You have to lose before you win. And hopefully, you know, that's where you take lessons from it. And you sit there and, yeah, inevitably you kick yourself and you say, man, if I could do it over. Well, doing it over is the next time around, yep, right? Yep. The next time around is when you get to do it over.
You didn't play in first round, second round.
But to be 22 or 23 years old, you know, in many cases across the board with who is out there, with a couple of upper 20s guys sprinkled in here and there, to have now 11 playoff games, not including play-in games, you know, underneath your belt is rather unbelievable.
Yeah.
You know, usually you're not even ready to win at all, much less win in the playoffs. Yeah. And so, well, and in fact, I got to take that back. You went, how many in the first round? You went six.
Six.
Okay, so this is 12 plus five last year. She got 17 playoff games.
Yep.
Yeah. You know, you get to some of these and it's like, you see these teams, and it's like, how many times, how many guys have been in the playoffs? And it's like, Andrew Wiggins, this is his first real time through. He had the one, you know, dalliance in Minnesota for a minute.
Tyus, too.
Right. Yeah. I mean, like, but you got guys now that have 17 playoff games already underneath their belt. Which is kind of crazy considering their ages.
Well, in 19, if you count the two play-in games, right. San Antonio and Golden State again, yeah.
Yep. So, I mean, you got some real high-leverage basketball experience, which I think will serve you very, very well.
Yes, it will.
In the future. I mean, you look around, and it's like, you don't think that helped guys like Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown make an Eastern Conference Finals very, very young in their career?
Yep.
With some veteran guys sprinkled in. I mean, like, those guys have a lot of playoff experience now at very young ages. And so just the idea that the Grizzlies have this much playoff experience at this point is very promising. And I do think that while it's disappointing in the moment, I think everybody took a step back and was like, that was unbelievable. That was a tremendous season that was way, way more than any of us bargained for.
Yeah, because you had Steven Adams out for 1 and 2, right?
Yep.
You lose Ja in 4.
Yep.
You have, I mean, you play with your backs against the wall. I mean,
that's right.
So the whole
you never played 1 minute
with your
in that series with your starting lineup.
Yeah, the DB was suspended for 3.
Right.
So, I mean, you never played with your entire lineup.
Not 1 minute.
In one Wait. Entire series.
You didn't play 1 minute in that series with the starting lineup.
Mm-mm.
What would be the starting lineup?
Dylan was at home.
Huh?
Dylan was suspended for
game
3.
Two, then. Oh, he was suspended.
He was suspended for 3.
Oh, but he was like out for game.
Yeah, Steve was out for 1 and 2. DB was out for 3.
Right.
Ja was out for 4. And then the rest of the series was just, you know.
You never had 1 minute.
And then you have game
in the series.
You have game 5 where you blow him out.
That's right.
So.
Oh, yeah. And that was the last thing that home fans saw.
Exactly.
In person. Which is incredible.
Kind of nice.
It's a good memory.
Yeah. Yeah.
You go out, memories.
You go out with a happy, like you go out, like you mentioned, like you fans go out with a smile on their face. As opposed to what the Suns went through, where they're like, they got a pile on their face.
Well, there was a lot of people asleep on Friday night, so they didn't have to experience the pain.
They just woke up and were like,
yeah. Yeah.
Oh, season's over.
Oh, that sucks.
They checked the box, they're like, okay.
All right.
It was a fun ride.
Oh, shoot. I was really hoping for a game 7.
Yeah. Anyway, the weekend.
Yeah. Number 2, the Year of End media session took place yesterday. All right, so I'm going to guess that a lot of you did not sit down and go through everything, but our own Mega Triplett had put together a compilation of the best of yesterday's media session. So we're going to let you hear what the guys had to say yesterday as they wrapped up the season.
Really just starting off, you know, since I've been here, since I've gotten here, I feel like, you know, we improve, you know, each and every year. I was losing in the bubble in that play-in and, you know, coming that following season, you know, winning the play-in and, you know, playing Utah and, you know, this season going to the second round. So obviously, you know, it's a good sign to show that, you know, we're not satisfied with the spots, you know, we've been in, you know, previous seasons and, you know, just having that experience of, you know, playoffs, you know, the last 2 years and for us to have this, you know, semifinals basically, you know, experience, I feel like it's great for us and, you know, it gives us a, you know, a lot of confidence. But as far as the team go, I feel like, you know, we just got to find ways to, you know, focus in on, you know, our individual selves, you know, taking care of our bodies so, you know, we're all available to be, you know, playing together and, you know, in those situations. And I feel like, you know, that definitely was, you know, a problem with, you know, not having, you know, guys really throughout the season. You know, we had a lot of guys go down, but I feel like it really helped us and, you know, gave a lot of other players confidence and, you know, show the world pretty much, you know, how deep, you know, this team is.
I thought we were going to be this good. We just talked about it too much. We wanted it more than you could imagine. The conversations that we had before the year started, right as the buzzer sounded in Utah in the locker room, all the way to training camp, it was just, we can really do this. We just got to, like, I ain't going to tell you everything we said, but we knew what it would take. And I think we really cared about it and put in the work for it. I think we deserved it. I don't know.
Yeah, I think we've just shown how great that we can be. I mean, we were the two seed this year. You know, we did much better than everybody thought. And I think we all know just how good we are. And I think that's why we're all kind of mad right now, because we know how great we are as a team. And I think, you know, we're all just really looking forward to these, you know, to this offseason and to the future, because, you know, we all had so much fun this year. And we know that we want to keep on having fun and keep on winning and keep on getting better. So now we, like, know what it takes to get there. So we just kind of got to, you know, get better to the point where, you know, once we do get there, we're just full on ready for, you know, anything.
I mean, I feel like we had a great year. I feel like we attacked every day in every game. So sometimes it's, I don't know, I'm lost for words when speaking about the season, because it was just so unforgettable. It was so memorable. And it was special. I think everybody improved. I think everybody can now see their potential of where they can go just throughout this league. And I feel like every guy in this league has a place that we can definitely make. And I think we gonna definitely keep going. I think so, for sure.
I mean, we got a special group. I mean, we've said it all year long. I mean, I feel like everybody here love this year, love this team, loved our locker room. It was the most fun I've had playing basketball, you know, probably since I first picked up a basketball when I was a kid. So, you know, and I'm sure that I'm not just the only one that feels that way. So it's evident that I'm sure Ja wants to be here, Jaren wants to be here, I want to be here, everybody wants to be here.
What a great year we've had. And I was just talking about, like, what a turnaround it's been year four since I've came to Memphis. Like, year one was a little shaky, it was a little crazy over here, it was something I've never seen or I wasn't used to. But we've kind of, like, you know, the 360 that the program and the work environment and the team, like, that they have made, it's just been tremendous. Like, you know, this organization is trending in the right direction. I think everybody else in the league knows that. So it's been really fun, really special to be a part of. Like, I enjoyed coming into work every single day. It's been awesome.
Playing here during the season and, like, really getting understanding of just literally from the front office, medical staff, coaches, players, everyone sings the same song. Like, everyone's on the same page and everything works really, really well. And there's just, like, a genuine care for one another. And along with that, it's just like everyone's just having fun. But there's, like, there's a really fine balance between, like, fun and work. And this organization plays that really, really well. So it's really enjoyable to be around. Again, like, if you're in the locker room on a win or a loss, you probably wouldn't tell. You know, if you just didn't even watch the game, you just came in, like, you wouldn't even know. You know what I'm saying? Just, like, everyone keeps the same energy. And it's not goofy, it's just, like, I don't know, just genuine. You know what I mean? Some people are helping out, talking about the game, some people are joking about, blah, 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 but it's still productive. Yeah, so very special group, man. Just the whole organization itself, very special organization. So, yeah.
Now that everybody else gets to pay attention, it's funny. It's like everybody, it's like you're going through it with them all over again. I mean, this isn't our first go around with each other. It's as if, like, everybody's meeting us and they think we're meeting each other. No. So I mean, it's funny. Like, I think it's super special. I think it's ironic that we're all on the same team. I don't really understand it. It's weird. We're all into doing the same stuff. We kind of identify with a lot of the same stuff. Personality wise, we are all very different, but we all bring a little bit like to the table that kind of we're all our own person. If you haven't noticed, and keeping that together is important. Never been a part of anything like this for sure. I think we all know it. It's something that really honestly goes unsaid, because it's just natural and it's just free flowing. And it's funny that everyone else is along for the ride now. Just, you know, it's just how it is. And we thank everybody too. Just,
You know, all these guys in this locker room are going to be lifelong friends. You know, the NBA is a small fraternity brotherhood, you know, type deal. So, you know, regardless if we get a chance to play together again or not, you know, our love and our connections will still be there. And, you know, whatever guys come in to fill those shoes or fill that role, hopefully we, you know, can still instill that Grizzly mentality, Grizz basketball, so we can kind of keep this thing rolling and protect this culture and identity that we've created here.
All right, so there's some moments from yesterday's media session that went on. All right, I'll go through it with y'all. What stood out to you? Kels? And even if it wasn't a clip that we showed.
Can it be funny ones, or you want to?
No, like just from guys yesterday.
But can it be funny?
Sure, yes.
The Steven Adams thing? That you guys saw it on Twitter.
The Duckmaster deal.
We've got it. We can play it.
I was legitimately laughing out loud. And
Peabody, like, was responding.
All right, so she brought up the Steven Adams thing. Here goes. Yeah. This Steven Adams talking about
the Peabody Ducks.
Before the season, I asked you if you knew about the Peabody Ducks and you thought it was a hockey team. Did you ever get to go see the Peabody Ducks? Like, did you ever cross that off the list yet, or no?
No, are these those little marching guys at the hotel? Yeah, no, I haven't done it yet. I gotta go see it. I think. Do young people do that? Little kids do. Okay, little kids. Yeah. I just don't want to show up, and I'm like. Yeah, but is it like grandpa and then really young kids?
I'm gonna guess.
Because I'm like in between. I don't want to be like the lame guy. Like,
I'm gonna
what's
guess.
What's this lame dude doing, bro? Like,
enough,
get out of here. This is for boomers, bro.
You could be the honorary duck master. I feel like.
I could be a duck master.
I feel like you could. I feel like you got enough cash. Yeah, you're a grizzly, a starter. Yeah.
Oh, is that a real thing? I thought you were bloody bullshit.
No,
yeah, it's, you could be a duck master.
Yeah, there's a guy who's like actually the duck master. And then they have honorary, like celebrities,
yeah.
And, you know.
Put that on the Tinder profile, eh, mate? Yeah. Yeah, duck master, mate. Oh, everyone will be swiping right on that, mate. Yeah. Fuck, duck master. Wow. Sexy stuff, huh?
Really just starting off.
What did he say? Did he say it's for booners?
Boomers.
Like
boomers.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's the funny one. On a serious note, I would say Zach Kleiman reaffirming that jaw, like, because I feel like everyone thought it was so sketchy.
Wait,
the way
Kelsey,
they dealt with
jaw. You're just gonna make us play everything. I got more.
We got Zach coming out.
Yeah, I got Kleiman clips.
No. What else?
Because I don't know the way they dealt.
I'm sorry for Rosa.
He's fine. The way they dealt with the injury, I think a lot of people were like, eh, "Like, is it more than we thought?" You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So he like reaffirmed non-surgical. He's gonna be fine way before the season starts. I think it was reassuring to everyone. I mean, I feel like he's just gonna have all these clips. Jaw saying the hell yeah thing where he's like, "If your question is, do I want to be in Memphis?" I think that was nice.
We don't have that clip.
Okay. Well, they asked him like if he wants to be here, and he's like, "I'm happy here. Like, yeah, I'll sign an extension." The one thing that. It's probably not like a good if you're a fan was Tyus Jones. Like he said a lot of really good things about Memphis and he's like, it's gonna take a lot. Like I'm gonna have to go and think about what I want personally and what I want professionally. And they're two different things because he obviously likes Memphis, but it doesn't look like he's like gonna.
I've wondered, and you know, this is one of the things that Hollinger brought up, which I thought was fascinating when he was on with us last week. He said, given the market and that, you know, somebody might fancy him being their starter, or maybe they don't. Who knows? But given the market and the way the cap's going to go in the coming years, etc., that it might behoove both the Grizzlies and Tyus Jones to do a one-year deal at what would be a high price for the 1 year. That way you get him, you know, he's back in the mix. He makes a good sum of money for the 1 year, and then he can enter free agency when there are more teams with cap space and the cap goes up, right? And so it might actually, for his own benefit, right? Now you might just want to secure, you know, he's got a kid now, you know, he might just want to secure, you know, whatever contract he can. A lot of guys go that way, but the idea that it would be out there for him, like, hey, this might, here's kind of a in between here, right? Like, we can't, right, give you the long-term security possibly, but we certainly want you to be a part of this and would love to have you here to be a part of this while also making a good amount of money.
And,
then you can still, at the end of the year.
Issue.
But, I mean, it's always a risk. Yeah. It's always a risk for everybody, right?
He did mention like how much like culture like means to him too, like more so than.
That's what I mean. He did say really good things about Memphis.
So like like when you think about it, like you come from being in Minnesota where you're from there, but you don't win that much. But you come here, you have like a group of guys, and then I mean, you got what played like $9-10 million this year.
Yep.
Yeah. But, I mean, you have a culture where it's established and everything is already kind of laid out. You go to somewhere like New York where you go back into like the limbo land, which is, so I mean.
Well, and how many teams are going to make Tyus Jones their starter? This is a league filled with amazing point guards.
Yeah, it is.
He is an amazing backup point guard.
I'd say the best backup.
Right.
The best backup point guard,
now you're going up against the starters for everybody. Mm-hmm. You've got to go out there and match up with De'Aaron Fox and John Morant and Chris Paul and Steph Curry. And you know what I'm saying? Like, that's a different deal. It's a different deal. And so I don't know if you are a team out there, if you say, hey, you know what? But there's certainly teams like that could use that. I honestly think, I don't even want to say this, but the team you played in the first round of the playoffs, Minnesota. All they need is somebody to set the table and throw it to Anthony Edwards and Carl Anthony Towns. You know what I'm saying? Like, he is a set-the-table guy. So that in those kind of situations, yes, right? Like, you don't need your point guard needs to be a role player.
Yeah.
Your point guard doesn't need to be
a superstar, scorer.
Doesn't need to be D'Angelo Russell.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? He just needs to set the table and get everybody else cracking, right? And so there are teams like that, for sure. Where you could be mega useful, but I hope they bring him back.
Me too.
Yeah, especially because of the jaw. The jaw injury thing has been a thing. And he has not only kept you afloat, he has kept you awesome.
Yeah.
And not just too, like, even like, remember a couple of years, like it was his first year, when we were like, yo, Johnny to add the floater. Tyus is like here.
Yep.
And like the next year, he adds the floater and he becomes like one of the most unstoppable players in the mid range. So like, I think they benefit off each other in some ways too. Like, they play off each other because they're like, they have such a good relationship. So I hope he comes back because he's good for everybody.
Not to mention, we all love him personally.
Yeah, he's good.
He's
dude,
the
man.
Best.
Good dude.
He's the best. He's a good dude.
Good dude, man.
Legitimately good dude. And so here's hoping. The other thing is, you know, you were talking about the Tyus thing and about, you know, coming from Minnesota, whatever. The thing that stuck out to me from the ones that we played is it's what Steven Adams talks about it. Steven Adams was on some awesome teams. Teams that went to West Finals.
Yeah.
Teams that went to the NBA Finals.
Yeah.
Like, he was around winning and superstars, and he didn't come from some rad organization, you know, where it's like, oh, wow, this is so different, right? He was around winning. And so for him to constantly recognize how special this is and talk about it, like, to me, that just carries way more weight.
Kyle even said, he said, you know, my first year here was
a shit show.
Yeah, but he's like, every year since then, and that is that key came from the, you know, the ultimate small market success San Antonio team. So what's that? Two things for me were I was interested to see, because we saw in summer league last year Bane on the ball more, so thought Zaire will probably play. What is he going to be doing? And he said he's going to be on the ball more in summer league.
Him and Santi are going to be like Shaq and Kobe.
Yeah, Zaire's going to be on the. They want him
he
to work
said
on.
He also forcing him to go to the weight room with him all summer.
But being on the ball Zaire more in summer league.
Like this.
The other thing too that I thought it's always interesting when you say like so for Zaire it's like what does coach really want you to work on? Well, I'm going to be in summer league working on my on the ball skills. What is this guy, Ja? What do you need? Get better defensively. This guy, what do you got to get better at? Oh, I got to get better doing this. Bro, and I'm not surprised. It's Jaren's, which is just a freaking list of things because that's the talent that he has. And he walked in with pages of stuff to go over. Taylor wants him to get better at playmaking out of the post. Like, it's – the sky still is a damn limit.
He has all of the abilities to do
it. All the tools, baby. You have all – their ceiling is, like, as high as freaking
– yeah.
You know,
right?
I don't know what building is really high, but yeah, it was good to see all of them be on the same kind of accord too. You just, like you talk about it too, like how everybody's on the same page. Yep. It wasn't like anybody like veering off from like, yo, where I'm gonna do this. It's like, yeah, this is the most fun I ever had playing basketball. These dudes are like, this means the world to me. This is a historic season. Thank you to everybody for everything. And then there was no guy just like doing his own thing. So that was good. That was good to listen to too.
Yep. Number three. All right. So the future. So a little window into it with Zach Kleiman, the general manager of the Memphis Grizzlies, who rarely speaks publicly, but the NBA Executive of the Year spoke at yesterday's year-end media session.
The goal is and continues to be to win the championship here. The decision making, you know, North Star is going to continue to be what's going to maximize, you know, our chances of doing so, you know, while building in a sustainable way, you know, and I'm excited, you know, to see what if any, you know, are the opportunities to, you know, try to make us better. We're never going to do something just to do something. You know, we're not going to do anything flashy for the sake of being flashy, but, you know, we're going to look at everything that might be on the table and we're going to try to use common sense at the end of the day to say what's going to, you know, increase our likelihood of you know, getting us to that point that I believe we're going to be able to get to.
Zach, two questions. One about Ja. Do you anticipate signing him to the most lucrative contract this franchise has ever had before?
Now, well, I'm of course not allowed to say specifics on that. Whatever I'm allowed to say under the NBA rules without violating the CBA, I hereby say about our what our plans would be for Ja. He's of course a cornerstone here.
The series, the team you just played, they're a core that's been together for a long time, and when the series was over they talked about Memphis trying to maintain its core. Is that something you hope to do, and how important is financial flexibility in keeping that when, you know, next summer Dez will be eligible for an extension and so on? How important is it to maintain that flexibility so that you can do that?
Definitely a lot to be said, you know, about core continuity. We're not going to have any issue paying anyone who we want to pay. There's never going to be any issue with retention here. You know, very grateful and wouldn't be, you know, in the spot doing any of this without, you know, Robert's vision and support and certainly his commitment, you know, on that end there. You know, not worried about small market notions or any of this or that. You know, we're not going to have any issue whatsoever keeping together whoever we ultimately decide, you know, along the way as we continue to prioritize continuity, you know, I think in large part with this group.
Zach, to win Executive of the Year in the NBA, you mentioned about how this isn't an organizational award. Can you just speak on what, as a group, the staff, the coaching staff, your front office, what this award kind of means to the organization?
Yeah, I mean, incredibly, you know, grateful that, you know, to have that recognition, you know, from my peers. But, you know, that is an organizational award. That doesn't happen without, you know, the amazing people that I'm surrounded with. That's front office, that's coaches, that's players. I mean, to Taylor, you know, I couldn't have, you know, more confidence in what Taylor's, you know, been able to do with this group, to cultivate with this group, the day-to-day, you know, work and approach that Taylor has. I wouldn't want to be doing this, you know, with anyone else, with the front office. I mean, with, you know, Tayshaun, Rich Cho, you know, well-established, you know, have been a GM. Tayshaun could have been yesterday. You know, if he wants to be, he will be at any point. Chris Makris, I don't think people, you know, quite know enough about Chris yet. I mean, Chris has been overseeing our scouting group, you know, since day one of this, you know, kind of front office. He's done a fantastic job. He's a rising star, and I would be shocked if he's not on, you know, doing a great job as a GM, you know, somewhere and probably in the not too distant, you know, future too. So I'm surrounded by tremendous people, but at the end of the day, like we're all focused on one thing, and that's, you know, that's winning the championship. And, you know, you're not going to see me, you're not going to see anyone celebrate anything until we get to that point.
Okay. By far the most relevant thing that came out of that was, you know, him saying, forget all everything you know about small market or notions that go along with it. I mean, he is saying the luxury taxes is no consequence to us. Don't even bring it up because I'm nipping this in the bud. This is an owner that is willing to go into the luxury tax if we need to in order to retain the players. And the reason that that is incredibly significant is because once upon a time, that exact team that we just referenced, which was those great Oklahoma City teams, Bennett wasn't going to go in the luxury tax. And next thing you know, you're moving off of James Harden.
Yeah,
right? You're moving off of James Harden. And you have choices that you have to make in these markets, right? When you're not Golden State, when you're not Los Angeles, when you're not New York, when you're not Brooklyn, there's a lot of these places where you want to be a receiver of the luxury tax money, yeah. And it makes a massive difference towards your bottom line. But instead of a payer, but it, he said, I wouldn't be in the position I was in, et cetera, et cetera. And so he's saying this team is more, and this owner is more than willing to be a luxury taxpayer, if that's what it means in terms of retaining our players and not losing our players because we can't afford them in Memphis. And I think that is by far the most relevant thing that Zach talked about yesterday, because inevitably that is a topic, right? It is, okay, you have this really awesome young team in a small market, but they won't be able to keep it together. That's the reality of small markets in the past.
And you have to be careful with it because it can, I mean, it was, you know, the Harden thing in OKC, that's the lesson.
That's like, right.
I mean, it's the lesson. That started it all, kind of started trending down after that when they had to move Harden.
Yep. And so it is the idea, though, and I understand the financial realities of being in a small market, right? This is not a win, right? And that's the good thing for Robert is, obviously, he didn't buy this. Michael Heisley wanted to profit off of owning the Grizzlies. That's why he sold the naming rights and kept the money. That's why he sold the food and beverage rights to Levy and pocketed the... He wanted checks right off the bat, right? Mm-hmm. I want to pay for this. And then we ran bare bones for the years. Almost in danger of being in the penalty.
Yeah.
You know, having to add just bogus ass Antoine Walker type contracts just to have the minimum salary level. Yeah. And then really didn't even have the minimum salary level. We had it on our books, but we didn't have it playing. And and Michael Heisley was trying to, I mean, again, he was a businessman that came from nothing, built up his own company, and he didn't buy this to... he didn't buy it as a passion project with, you know, winning the championship is what matters most. Now, once they got good, to Isaac's credit, he did pay those guys, right? He did. We didn't lose we never lost somebody because they weren't willing to pay him. But this is a whole nother deal because we weren't paying guys all NBA supermax contracts.
Here's also,
you know what I mean? This is next level stuff.
Well, this is also the truth of it too. So these were the final eight teams in the NBA playoffs: Grizzlies, Warriors, Mavericks, Suns, Miami, Philly, Boston, Milwaukee. The Grizzlies and the Mavericks are the only two that aren't in the luxury tax.
And the Mavericks don't have as many good players.
Yeah, Grizzlies are the only two. And now you go to the West Finals and the East Finals. Dallas is the only team not in the luxury tax.
Yep.
The other ones all are.
Yep.
Now, I don't know what their tax bills are now, but like at the beginning of the year, all these teams were in the tax.
Brinks truck.
Yeah. I mean, well, here's the good thing. On the job front, as you were talking about, Kels, I mean, we knew if you don't F it up, we knew on draft night, You don't have this up. You got this guy for 8 years.
Mm-hmm.
Minimum.
Yep.
And then you go from there. But the idea that we're already, you know, he's now just going to be entering year four, and he couldn't be happier with his situation and would sign whatever is put in front of him. And that, like, it seems like everybody's simpatico on this. Like, the maximum amount that they can pay John Morant, they are willing to pay John Morant.
Yeah.
And John Morant is, give me the pen.
Yeah, you don't have stories about
it's the best.
You don't have the stories about
nope.
him wanting to go other places.
Nope.
As long as the nerds on Twitter that make those
that
photoshops.
It
don't matter.
I don't even see him anymore.
Like the John Morant like Bucks jerseys or Lakers jerseys.
I see them Lakers jerseys all the time.
Yeah, like that ain't a thing, bro. 12 wants to be here.
Nope. Number four. Western Conference Finals is not going to feature the Dallas Mavericks. I don't know if I've ever been more shocked with a game that did not involve the Grizzlies or whatever.
When did you turn it off?
I didn't. I left it on.
You left it on the whole time?
Oh, yeah. I wanted to watch it. Yeah. I was in the background. But, I mean, I started playing on my phone. But I did not turn it off. I turned it on. I tell you what. I did flip it when I saw the thing on Twitter that Pujols was entering the game as a pitcher.
Okay.
So I did watch Pujols pitch and give up back-to-back bombs. But then I flipped it over because I just wanted to see how gruesome it was going to get. And I didn't want to miss the postgame show.
Oh, yeah.
Well, just in case there was like a crazy historic comeback.
What?
What?
No.
I didn't keep watching. I'm just saying. Maybe that was one of the reasons
he
kept it on.
So it was, 72 to 42 at halftime?
No, bro. They had 36 in the third quarter.
It was 27.
Yeah, they had 27. Yeah,
but
that's right. That's right, because Luke had the same amount. Okay, 27.
They didn't get to 30 until the third quarter.
So it was like
it was a 30-point game at half.
Yeah, and then it was like when I went and was screwing around at halftime, and I checked my phone before I walked back to the TV to see if they had like made a dent in it, and they were down 38. Like a couple minutes in. And I was like, you would think they'd come out in the third quarter like and just be like, you know, let the other team is up by 30.
Yeah, it was 57.
Right now,
57,
just get this thing down to 16, this thing down, whatever. I mean, you're really grasping at straws there, but the fact that they came out in the third quarter and started getting their ass beat even more, I was like, oh my God.
At least they scored a little more.
Yo, at the beginning of that game, William will attest, I turned to William and I'm like, oh boy. Because if you were watching the beginning.
Yeah, I was watching
the beginning. Wait, I wasn't. I was at
Dinwiddie
Jones.
It was Luka. Yeah. He went bang, bang, then hit a two, and he turns around and he's yelling at those Phoenix fans. I'm like, oh, you are in a world of crap tonight.
Is that what Lil Wayne tweeted?
Lil Wayne tweeted that the other day.
Oh, that was the other.
You know, the crazy thing is, I mean, that was like the first 3 minutes of the game. And I was like, oh, boy.
It's going to be a long night.
Well, because you're thinking, like, here's Luka versus, right? Like, I mean, that's what everybody's saying. It's like, here's this one guy, and what's he going to be doing? And they start running doubles at Devin Booker, which the irony of that is so hilarious because our old buddy Joakim Noah. You remember that fight they had?
Yeah, in the pickup game in the summertime.
Over being doubled?
Yeah.
Might should have practiced this some more. I mean, and I'm going to look, when you're wrong, you're wrong. The Jason Kidd thing
is worse.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
I mean, people change. People change. That's a lesson to me. People change. What you were is not always what you're going to be.
Yeah.
And he is a great example of that. And I mean, you watch him coaching on the sidelines at defense. He had them guys swarming like crazy.
Swarming, switching and everything.
And you know what's wild? You know, they were absolute hell on the Grizzlies this year.
Yeah.
And there is part of me that, you know, things have changed so drastically in the NBA, the way the NBA's played, et cetera. And when you make the amount of threes that they were able to make, it's just...
Bro,
both those games yesterday, it's like... You know, Greg Popovich used to bemoan what the NBA's become and just said, just tell me who made more threes and you'll probably know who won the game, right? But yesterday, both them shooting fireballs, Spencer Dinwiddie.
He was hot, man.
Yeah, hot. And that's why I kept saying, right, like, you know, remember when we were playing Minnesota, and I said, bro, end this in six, because if you get to seven, you never know when the team's going to, with now teams shooting 53s, if they knock down 21 of them, you are dead. You got no chance. For real. It's make or miss, and if you're shooting that volume of them, then, you know, I don't want to leave it to chance, because that is so random. But there was nothing random about that ass beating. I don't understand. That just, I mean, they just did not show up.
Yeah, Boog didn't show up. Chris Paul didn't show up. Nobody showed up.
Aiden quit.
They benched Aiden in the fourth quarter.
Aiden quit. No, there was a moment. Now, I read somewhere where Monty Williams went over to him or whatever about a sub.
Yeah.
And that Aiden, like, didn't want to go back in or something. Oh, and shit. He said something to him. Whatever, and I guess that's when Biombo got up, and then Ayton said something, and Monty Williams walked over to him and got in his face and said, what'd you say? And, like, it became a thing. That's why he was so weird in the postgame.
He said
where he was like, internal.
It's internal, yeah.
Yeah,
he's trying to – Ayton wants to get – he ain't getting paid now.
He's going to end up in Charlotte.
Somebody's
he's going to end up in Charlotte.
I mean,
oh, no, he's not going to be in Phoenix. Yeah. No, so he will get paid. Like, it's just not going to be in Phoenix.
Go to Charlotte, play with my boy LaMelo.
Yeah.
Go to the East.
He's going
to
go somewhere, for sure. But it's not going to be there.
I will say.
That was the lamest. I just still can't get over it. That Phoenix team was awesome
by
this
time,
year.
By the time I turned on that game, it was already a bloodbath because I was on my Kelsey last night watching a little stick and puck, eh?
Oh, God.
Rangers and Pins, game seven.
Put my name in that.
Yeah.
How dare you?
I was watching it.
They lost.
Yeah, they did. They lost in overtime,
4-3.
Yeah, my Penguins are up 2-0. I think the Leafs lost,
they blew a 3-1 series lead. The Penguins did.
You know what you
mean? I was watching, but it started at 6, so by the time I flipped over to the game, I was like, what the hell is happening here?
That's exactly what I did. I flipped it on. I was like,
his Penguins tweet text to us about my Penguins being up 2-0, that was the version of Devin Booker against Luka.
Yeah.
Right? It all went wrong afterwards.
Went
that Luka special.
Yeah.
And all that thing. I mean, look, think about this. I mean, that loss is so bad that your opinion of everyone is destroyed.
People ask Chris Paul if he's going to retire because he got his ass kicked.
Your
so
opinion
bad.
Of Chris Paul, your opinion of Devin Booker.
Are we talking about Pat Bev? Is that one of them?
But it's no. It's just an altering.
Yeah.
Mikal Bridges? Where was he?
Witness protection.
People acted like he was Tony Allen.
He got.
Bro, Luka wore their ass out.
Nobody was Tony Allen yesterday.
Nobody.
He wasn't Pat Bev.
No,
I'm Pat Bev made it harder on Luka Doncic.
No, nobody.
I think, are we talking about
nobody
Pat
can
this
guard
morning?
Luka.
No. But like that whole Mikal Bridges. Where are you?
Yeah.
Where are you, bro? Where are any of you?
Yeah,
there's nobody.
Just flat. And I'll tell you this. They are not – the Mavs are not like – you look up and down their roster and you're like, geez, I don't know, man. But I'll be damned if they don't have wing defenders. They got guys that fly around, and they are going to be a problem for Golden State. The same way that they were a problem for the Grizzlies, because Golden State don't want to play like that.
No.
They don't want to play like that. And Luka's fine. Just he'll run his half-court stuff, and they'll get it. They won't even get into the play until 16 seconds left sometimes. They don't even care. And it's like, that is frustrating as all hell if you're Golden State and you're trying to get out there and run and get into space and
Because he's going to be cooking. He's going to be seeking out Steph Curry. Bro.
And it's just these guys that you don't have that much thought about, like Finney Smith and Bullock and whatever. But you watch them defend. They swarm your ass. Yeah.
And Dallas has the best player in the series.
Yes.
Dallas has the best guy. So.
Luka, bro, that man, he's
a bad dude.
In a game
man.
Seven, what, 38-9-9?
Disgusting.
His averages, bro,
freaky.
That's some real, like, all right, bro.
Well, you think about
game
this,
seven,
the
I want
last
that dude.
2 years, you know, when he got knocked out, he's playing a team that's got Kawhi and Paul George. You know what I mean? Yeah.
And even he's special, like Pat Bev on Get Up, like, he's even giving Luka his props. Those, like,
look, you like, don't have, bad they don't have anything to put, Golden State doesn't have anything to put on him.
No, nothing. Andrew
who
Wiggins,
will,
good
who
luck.
Will they?
Huh?
Like, right. Who will cover
Andrew
Luka?
Wiggins, probably.
You think?
Otto Porter, if he's healthy.
What?
He couldn't even keep it straight.
They're going to put Wiggins on him, probably, because he's long. And Luka going to torch him.
Dude, Luka will kill
him. You know what, bro? For people to say, like, there was a conception of, like, he may be soft. Bro, when you talk trash.
Soft?
No, when he came in.
Well, I tell you this, like, he takes
trash talking like personal.
He is extra though.
Oh yeah,
he's I mean extra. He's
everyone's extra now though.
It's really annoying. Yeah, it marred that Boston Milwaukee game. It did.
Yeah,
it marred it every time anybody got a, you know, even a bump. It was, you know.
It's annoying as hell.
And when you combine that with freaking Kane Fitzgerald, it's like a disaster. So anyway, congrats to Dallas. I'll be rooting for him. Yeah. I get to root for Luka.
I might root for him. Because like I said, the misconception of what he was saw. Yep. But like he's shown, like, if you talk crazy to him, remember he was walking off the court?
Oh, yeah.
He was like, everybody talking trash when they're up.
Yep.
He coming out gay.
Everybody's tough.
Bust their ass, bro. Yep. So shout out Luka, bro.
Number four. I could not help but think about this.
That is number four. This is number five.
Oh, five. Yeah. Okay, here's a litmus test. So the Eastern Conference Finals, it's Boston. They took care of business yesterday in the Game 7 on their home floor. And they were awesome, and Grant Williams shot 18 threes. Figure that out.
That is so ridiculous when I'm watching that game. I was like, is it like just... My TV rewinding itself, and I'm seeing the same
The first 20 threes of his career, he missed.
Yeah. It's amazing what he has become. And Peyton Pritchard knocking down threes.
Shout out to Grant Williams, Johnny Ball.
They shot 55 threes.
We're talking about how are they going to be able to shoot threes. Remember
coming
that?
Into the series.
Yeah. We're like, yo,
because I pulled up the numbers. Milwaukee was like first or second in terms of giving up two-pointers. Okay. So you can't beat them. But they were like 29th or 30th in terms of three-pointers they give up. So are you playing a team that will make you pay from three? And the answer yesterday was absolutely. They made them pay from three. And you know what I found? And so congrats to Boston. Unbelievable. It sets up a really great Eastern Conference Finals, I think. But you know what? After that Dallas game ended last night, when I said the litmus test coming into this, you think about this year, right? This season. And the two teams that made the Grizzlies look horrible this year.
We're hit. Boston and Dallas.
Boston and Dallas. Yeah.
That's it. And I wonder if the Grizzlies were, like, if we should have paid attention, like, hey, you know how terrible they made us look? Like, we should take notice of that because those were, it didn't appear to be unique because, interestingly enough, we played with Phoenix.
Yeah.
For sure. Up and down, right?
Yep.
And it wasn't like they beat the crap out of the Grizzlies, even though that first game they really did, but that was early in the year. But Phoenix, Milwaukee is a lot like the Grizzlies in the sense that they have got to get stops and get out in transition. Their half court is just bogus. You want to talk about, like, altering opinion forever. Bro, he was so not built for that moment. Like, in the first half, it was swing. They threw it to him. Bro, he missed by 20 feet.
Yeah,
he threw it in the stands. I'm like, he is a good shooter.
Yeah.
That is not... when you're wide open and swing, and now you've got the three, and I know, I've watched him 1,000 times, I know what kind of shooter Grayson is. When you airball like by 20 feet,
and open,
that has nothing to do with your ability to shoot the basketball.
You got the yips. You got the yips.
No, it's
you got the yips.
Your ears.
You got the yips,
yeah,
man.
That is between your ears.
He last two games, he was 0 for 8 from three. Game 6, Game 7, he was 0 for 8. He was...
Well, that's what he has to do. Stretch it out for Giannis so that five guys can't guard him.
Dude, there was a screen grab yesterday. There was legitimately five dudes guarding him.
Oh, of course. Who else are they going to guard? Wes Matthews?
Yeah, the Middleton thing.
Budenholzer did screw up some. I mean, he didn't play my boy Javon, and Javon was his chance.
Yeah.
Because Javon could have pressed them, could have kept the ball moving.
Yeah.
He did shoot well from three once he went to Milwaukee. George Hill stinks.
He does.
And they don't, like, I mean, this didn't have, like, in a game like that, you need guys that are there for it.
Because mm-hmm. you know Giannis is there for it.
Yeah.
You need somebody else to be there for it with
him. And you know what's crazy? You watch that, obviously you watched the game yesterday.
like, we would all say that was not a great Giannis game.
No.
No.
By any means. And he, look
at his numbers. Oh, I know, they're ridiculous.
26-20.
He had 26-20. When I looked at the box score at the end of the game, I'm like, okay.
And not assists, Kelsey.
That's like anybody else's best game of their life.
But we had 10-8-6 in the first quarter. I was like, what in the world?
26-20 and
9 assists and 2 steals and a block.
That's outrageous.
Like, come on, bro.
I remember when we had the Milwaukee game here, and I said, I thought the Grizzlies did an unbelievable job on him. We got to the postgame, it was like 30-17.
Yeah,
and
it's like,
I thought we did great.
Yeah.
Do you think they asked? Do you think they need to add something else? I mean, I know Middleton was hurt, but you
no, that is what they needed.
Middleton's the one.
They Middleton. Just yes. Yeah, but look, there's a people could say, oh well, they lost Marcus Smart, they lost Rob Williams, whatever. Look, when you are putting $30 million into a guy, that's the lesson. You can't lose the $30 million guy. No. When you start paying guys, and this is what the Grizzlies, you know, quest is going to be in years to come. You ain't got money for the rest of your roster. So you ain't got that good of players on the rest of your roster because you got that money sunk into
and that's why there's
three guys and you better have all of them.
Yeah.
You got to have them available. You only got – that's why they make that kind of money.
I'm scared about the Celtics thing because we talk about like JT and Jaylen Brown and Marcus Smart. Like those three. But like the rest of their dudes, they got – I'm sorry. They got bums.
Grant Williams.
Bro, Al Horford is not a bum. They Al Horford is not a bum.
They got bro.
Al Horford is good.
That's crazy.
Okay, you got four. Give me
Grant
one
Williams is good.
Okay, five. Give me one. Give me somebody else.
Peyton Pritchard. Don't you dare! It's all we've got right now. Tyler Hero. Max Strus. Stand up. Tell me Max Strus is American.
He is American.
We need him.
He's German.
What?
He's an American. German. A lot of Germans are named Max.
No. I think this guy's. I think
he's from Illinois.
Let's go.
American basketball. You know where we went to school?
Max Strus.
We went to college.
Huh? Lewis.
We went to college.
Lewis and DePaul.
No, bro.
Hey.
What?
That was a question.
That was a question for him.
Oh, what?
He didn't know that.
Where did Max?
You didn't give me a chance. Lewis and DePaul.
Ding 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 ding.
Well, I didn't even understand what. What I is said, Lewis?
Where did he go to college?
Where?
DePaul.
What was the Lewis in?
He went to Lewis first, Lewis College, and then transferred to DePaul.
Even let me ask the question. He's look at that Google and just answer the question.
I'm quick with it.
He's but like, no. Oh, I know.
Max Strus, stand up.
Hey, he killed us in summer league. You'll never forget. He walked off on our
game
ass.
Winner in Conchar's face.
Yeah. Why don't White cry?
Yeah. Let's see.
It's tough. He can hoop.
Fun though. Sports dunk shots.
Hey, he replaced his own guy though, Duncan Robinson though, because you know Duncan Robinson was their guy.
Yeah.
Now Max Strus.
You mean it's $90 million?
Like Derek White, he didn't shoot the ball with this. Derek White can play.
He can play. I'll give you that one.
Yeah, he can play.
They got 7 or 8.
Yeah, they do.
Yeah,
about 7.
7 or 8.
Yeah, like, but that's like what most teams have.
I know, right. Like, when I
no,
watch
no
them,
team
I'm
has
like,
12
bro,
stars.
I'm like, bro, like Jaylen. You mean Jaylen and JT? I'm just like, the rest of them, I'm just like,
bro, you watch the Dallas Mavericks and it's the same thing. This is why I wonder.
And by the way, that's how people watch the Grizzlies.
Hey.
They did.
Well,
they're not right. I'm saying they're not right.
Yeah.
But they do. They go, oh, it's John Morant and a bunch of dudes.
You do wonder because of how Boston and Dallas
so you
play.
Do, right? And you're saying this about them.
About Boston. Yeah, you're right.
It is a copycat league. And if you have Boston and Dallas, if they end up in the finals with how they play, slower, half court, grind out stuff.
Find wing defense, man.
That's all you really need, bro.
Wing defense that can shoot. Wing defense that can shoot threes. That's it. You know what I mean? And that's the problem with the – that's why the Bridges thing is so devastating. Yeah. That's tough.
Yeah.
That's tough.
Shout out to NBA Adoka too, bro. His first season, bro. People said he couldn't do it at the beginning.
He could get a championship his first season.
Yeah, like people said at the beginning he couldn't do it. Like they were struggling. They have that team meeting and
Udoka
everything.
Udoka and Kidd.
Yeah,
Kidd. Everything flips for them, so.
I thought both of them would take a step back because, you know, you talk to coaches around the league, they all think Brad Stevens and Rick Carlisle are awesome.
Exactly.
I think the I think Carlisle is an awesome coach. I do think he is – it feels like he might have already aged. Like – the younger guys maybe not listening to him as much. Like, don't the message doesn't get
defense,
across.
Defense, man. defense.
Yeah. Yeah.
Defense wins. Defense, and yeah. They had the best offense. And they also ran into the Clippers. I mean, that's who they got beat by.
Yeah.
A better team.
Yeah.
It's not like they lost to it, you know. But still. Look, he wasn't out of the first round in 10 years, and Jason Kidd's in the damn West Finals.
By the way,
what, more wins in his first year than Jason Kidd?
Because you mentioned the Clippers. Speaking, the odds for next season are already out. The Clippers are the favorite in the Western Conference next year.
Are you being serious?
And the Brooklyn Nets are the favorites in the East.
That's stupid.
Who makes this?
Dead serious. The Clippers.
The season's not even over yet,
bro. Yeah, no. The Clippers are plus 500.
What are the Grizzlies?
Grizzlies have the 10th best odds. I can't remember what the number was.
Why are they already dropping odds and the season not over yet?
Yeah, the Grizzlies have the
chance. Because they can take bets on it.
Yeah, that's
for degenerates.
Why. Yeah. You don't even know who's going to be on these teams
yet.
That's what's crazy about it. You got to be hardcore degenerate.
The Grizzlies are 19-1 to win the title.
Is that good?
Yeah, that's
the Lakers low. The Lakers are 22-1.
That's not value. 19-1.
No value at 19-1.
No.
Yeah, Clipper. The Nets are the favorite, plus 450. Clippers plus 550.
Johnny Net.
Warriors plus 600. Celtics plus 600.
They must know Ben Simmons is going to be healthy.
Yeah.
All right, let's take a break. Right. We'll be back into this. Chris Barnes Show.
WynnBET, the official sports book partner of the Memphis Grizzlies, is Tennessee's premier digital sports betting app. They're bringing you the action of real money sports betting right in the palm of your hand with some of the best odds in the game. From boosted parlays to live in-game odds on every major sport, they have what you need to win. Sign up today and use the promo code GRIZZ. And after placing your first $10 wager, you'll receive $200 to bet with. That's GRIZZ. There's no better way to enjoy basketball than with some extra winnings in your pocket to use for all of your favorite bets. And be sure to check out the WynnBET Sports Bar at FedEx Forum the next time you catch our Grizzlies in action. Betting is a team sport. Join the WynnBET team and bet with the best. Must be physically located in Tennessee and 21 years of age or older to participate. If you or someone you know needs assistance with a gambling problem, call the Tennessee Red Line at 1-800-889-9789.
Check out the all-new WynnBET Sports Bar located at FedEx Forum just off Beale Street Al. Open every event night plus non-event Saturday and Sunday starting at 11 a.m. The WynnBET Sports Bar is your lock for the best local brews, food, and all the games. Sports fans looking for action and a little extra juice can receive exclusive in-bar only promotion, including odds boosts, free bets, and more from the WynnBET Sportsbook app. Plus, watch all the games. College and pro with over 30 TVs and Sunday NFL tickets. Parking is free for guests and available in the Gossett Motors Garage. For more information, go to FedExForum.com.
Don't put off getting your oil changed, Memphis, the Grizzlies' official partner. Take 5 oil changes faster than you think. There's no appointment needed. There isn't even a waiting room. Yep, you heard that correctly. Take 5 oil changes so fast you don't even have to get out of your car. You can take advantage of Take 5's fast, friendly, and simple service at any of their locations across the Memphis area. And remember, at Take 5, you stay in your car because they're faster than you think. That means you won't even have time to show off your perfect jump shot or your killer crossover. Take 5, the stay in your car 10-minute oil change. Nothing goes better with a great game than a cold brew and a bag of Naughty Pretzels. The official pretzel of beer is now available at Super Low Foods. Complete your game day party with one of 6 delicious Naughty Pretzel flavors. Mom's Original Savory Italian, Honey Mustard, Cinnamon Roll, Smoky Cheddar Bacon, Mesquite Barbecue, and Tasty Hot Wing flavors. Remember, no game day is complete without a bag of Naughty Pretzels. So hurry to your local Super Low Food store and stock up for the game. Super Low Foods is a proud partner of the Memphis Grizzlies.
It's a Grizzlies game day.
It's a big day. Mm-hmm. Grizzlies game day, Grizzlies at Nuggets, opening day in Major League Baseball, Masters Day one. Did we ever think we were going to see Tiger Woods on a golf course again?
You didn't even mention the real sport coming back today. It's kickball season again. Let's go!
I see the joy in his eyes for kickball season to begin.
Rise and Grind with Jessica and Megan. Live daily at 8 a.m. on GrindCityMedia.com.
Grizz fans, the official Grizzlies mobile app is your key to the game. It's an all-in-one experience. Keep track of a team with news, social media, and team information. Plus, you can log into Grind City Media for articles, videos, podcasts, and streaming content like The Chris Vernon Show and Rise and Grind. You can see what's going on at FedEx Forum and use the app as your ticket and mobile wallet for contact-free payment in the arena. The official Grizzlies mobile app, your key to the game.
Taco Bell has all the classic flavors you're craving. Order them ahead on the Taco Bell app for quick pickup in the drive-thru, or get them delivered right to your door. Are you a true Taco Bell fan? Join our team and eat for free, plus score flexible hours, scholarships, and more. Apply at jobs.tacobell.com today. Hours and participation may vary by location. Additional terms and fees may apply. Franchisees are independent operators and are responsible for their own employment practices and benefits.
What's up, y'all? This is Chase Rice hanging outdoors with an ice-cold Mountain Dew. You know, it's easy to tell who really loves the outdoors. One thing, there's a rack on your car and a hitch on the back of your truck. There's a garage full of toys from wakeboards to dirt bikes. And there's a cooler full of Mountain Dew, always at the ready. Because when it's time to get out and do, you know, hit the lake or the deer stand, a cooler of Mountain Dew, that's as important a piece of outdoor gear as your four-wheeler or your fishing rod. Mountain Dew. Do the Dew.
Welcome back to the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com. Presented by WinBet. Now, back to your host, Chris Vernon.
Think you know what's going on. You think you got it made. Your love's on fire, but he's a liar. I think you just got played. Played like a bag. At an Alabama hold down. He never told you.
Hi, we're back. Chris Vernon Show. WinBet. You can go to your app store. You can type in WinBet. Find the one that says WinBet Tennessee. You can download it today. Official sportsbook of the Memphis Grizzlies. New user offer. You can bet $10 and win $200. And I guess we're going to have East Finals, West Finals. Both are very good. I know the Heat are small favorites in Game 1. I've got to imagine that the Warriors are favored in Game 1 against the Dallas Mavericks. And I know that the – I was surprised at this. The Heat are not favored in that series against Boston. And the Mavericks are heavy underdogs against the Golden State Warriors. So
– would your prediction be Golden State, Boston?
Yeah.
Like yours. Forget
– oh, no. I'm a Miami guy.
Yeah, I'm gonna go. I'm a Miami Dallas.
I think whichever Miami, one of these East teams,
Miami Dallas would be wild because Miami. Of their history.
What's their history?
Oh yeah, because of 2011
and what?
2011 and the 2006,
yeah,
right?
It was a 2005, 2006.
Yeah, that was Shaq, the Dwayne Wade getting fouled 150,000 times, but not really getting fouled.
And I was like,
No. And then the Dirk title where he knocked off LeBron and Wade and all them, their first season when they got together as the quote Heatles.
Yeah.
That was unbelievable.
Warriors are -5 in game one.
Oh, is that right?
Warriors are -5, Heat are -1.5.
I don't think that, I mean, we'll see. I just blew it. At this point, bro, I
thought the two best teams were the Suns and the Heat, so
yeah.
I'm already out on one of those.
They were the best home team in the NBA, too, bro. Just imagine Suns, that. Yeah. You're the best home team in the NBA. On your in your last game, you get like
destroyed.
Face beat in.
I think whichever East team wins will win it all. Oh, I mean, no. I'm sticking with the Celtics. I picked Boston at the beginning of the playoffs. I'm going to run with it.
Stick with Tatum.
Gotta stick with
you
the
Celtics. You can't trade on Mel. Yeah.
Roser, we're going to have to deal. We got to deal with this with Devin.
What?
He's cost us a listener.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
Chase has tweeted me. I have been listening to your show for years.
Years.
But until you kick that racist Devin off your show, I will no longer be listening. If you and John Roser said the N-word the entire show, you'd be canceled. But Devin is allowed to spew his racism. Done! Exclamation mark.
Chase, he's done with us.
Chase, I will remember you. Chase, I hate to tell you this, but Devin jokingly saying cracker, which offends literally none of us, is nothing like saying the N-word.
Sorry, buddy.
I'm sorry.
It might be you, bro.
Yeah.
It might be you.
I don't know what has happened in your life that made you be very sensitive to cracker, but Roser and I just frankly do not feel the same way.
No.
Now, we do regularly defend the white basketball players that Devin slanders.
Yes.
And that is extremely racist. There's no way around that. But, you know, look,
that's how it goes. Like if you show up at like a the park, like the park to play, like the white dude is. He's gonna have to prove his way. Yeah, yeah.
Hey, I'm gonna tell you something. For Chase and anybody else out there,
sorry, Chase.
Getting offended by this show is not the thing. No, we're here to joke around and have fun. All right, that's it. So you want to go be mad about something, go be mad about something. There's probably a better show for you. But if you can find some crap to be mad about with this show, you are just really looking to be mad.
Yeah.
All right, Campbell, he's done with me. He's even listening for years, and you said cracker, and he's done. He said no more. And he put an exclamation point on it.
You guys
he said
hell of
done.
Things.
I am done. I'm going to go listen to something else. He's done with me. He's done. He's been listening to me for years, Devin. You said salty cracker and ended it. Shoot.
I'm sorry, Chase.
He's not listening anymore.
He's done now.
Oh,
geez, Louise. Number six. What'd you watch? Kelsey?
Yo, my chest hurts, bro.
Come with it.
My laptop won't charge.
Oh, it's not plugged in.
Oh.
He stole the charger. We got charger action.
I'm at literally zero.
What? Is it on your computer what you watched?
No. Oh. I was just trying to go in the chat. It sounded like it was juicy.
Oh, God.
Oh, is the chat getting juicy?
Oh, no.
What did I watch? Oh, I didn't watch something new, but I did watch something.
Okay.
Like, new to me.
All right.
You know what theme it's going to be. Have you ever heard of Gypsy Blanchard? You guys, anyone?
Well, I've heard of that.
Gypsy Blanchard?
Yeah.
No.
Heard that name?
No.
No. Okay, so it's this story. And okay, so I'm just going to the show is called The Act, and it's one season right now. It came out in 2019, and it's essentially the reenactment of this
murder.
There is a murder.
Yeah, of course there is.
But
have you ever watched anything that somebody doesn't get murdered in?
No, this one's really good, though. Guys, watch out. This one's really good.
Some kinky stuff, man.
If anything ever happens with her, people are gonna come to us and they're gonna be like, what sign do you need, dumbass? She talks about murder every single
week.
Oh, my bad.
I find true crime very interesting.
All right, go ahead.
This little girl was, since she was very little, her mom would tell her that stuff was wrong with her, and so then their house got taken out by Katrina, so they moved and there was no hospital records. So now it's just the mom's word. She's like, she has this. She's a cancer survivor. She can't see, she can't walk, she's in a wheelchair, all this. It turns out the kid was fine, and the mom was just trying to keep her her own. She wasn't trying to hurt her, but she's trying to keep her at home and her little baby and da da da. Eventually, the girl is like, I know I can walk. I know my hair is fine. I know I can eat. I don't need this feeding tube. She finds this guy online.
What are you, a feeding tube?
She's convinced these doctors. And when one doctor says your daughter doesn't need this, she'll go to a different doctor. And she's like, my daughter needs this.
But the girl's fine?
Mm-hmm. But obviously, all the meds that she was getting, it messed her up. So, she didn't feel great.
What's the deal with the mom?
Well, she kills the mom.
What the hell?
Bro, what kind of stuff you be
this
on?
This is real?
Bro.
It's a real story, yeah.
Where did this happen?
Well, she was from, where's Katrina hit? Louisiana. She was from Louisiana, and then she moved, wherever after Katrina hit.
What the heck is going on?
Yes. Yeah, it's the Munchausen syndrome.
Yeah, Munchausen,
proxy. So, she was
I have never heard of this.
Yeah.
This story.
Yeah, it's a real story. The girl has been, obviously the mom's not alive anymore, but the girl's been on Dr. Phil and stuff, and not that it means anything, but, it's a true,
Is she the Catch Me Outside girl?
No, it's a real thing. She was getting what are those things where Make-A-Wish Foundation? She was getting a bunch of those things. She went to Disneyland a bunch of times. Habitat for Humanity built them a house with a wheelchair ramp. It was a real thing, and literally nothing was wrong with her. She thought, she trusted her mom, so, she wasn't, she's not guilty of that, but the mom was...
So everybody knows this story. This is a very...
It's a very, famous story. Well-known story.
How'd she kill her?
She
stabbed her, I think.
Oh,
and
no.
Then,
oh, that's no. That, yeah. I mean, that is hardcore.
She stabbed her and then mailed the... I'm not giving anything away because the show is about this story that everyone knows. Mailed the knife to her boyfriend's house where she went afterwards. And when she... I know. And then she got there and she didn't want her mom's body in the house for too long. So she wrote on her mom's Facebook... Am I allowed to say the B word?
Yeah.
She said the bitch is dead on her mom's Facebook, and that's how they found the mom's body. Someone was like, that's a weird post.
Bro, what in the...
Mm-hmm. See, this
where,
is...
What, where is this all? Where is... What can I watch
this? It's on
this?
Hulu.
Dude, I might watch this. Bro.
Yeah, it's...
It's a season long?
Yeah.
This sounds
is
like
it, is it real, or is it like a dramatization of
it's,
the...
It's yeah, it's a dramatization
oh,
of it.
Oh, so it's actors
yeah.
playing this.
Yeah, but out. It's like, I've seen the actual document... Like, there's a... I think it's on 2020, like the real documentary.
Wow. Yeah.
It's like, it's spot on. Like, the show is exactly how things go. It's just like a nice...
How long is it?
I mean, I watched it in one weekend.
One season?
Yeah.
It's one season. Mm-hmm. How many episodes would you say?
I'm not...
More like 6 or more like 12?
More like 6.
Huh. Well, I can do that. I can pump that out. I can pump that out pretty quick.
It is summer. I don't have Grizzly games tonight.
I got nothing to do tonight.
And since you
she also gets really into some like weird kinky shit. But that's like another thing. Because that's another thing. Her mom lies to her about the year she was born. So she thinks she's like, I forget the, I think she thinks she's like 14 or something. It turns out she's actually 18.
Oh, she's like Manu Bol.
Or Serge Ibaka.
Or Jonathan Kuminga.
Everybody's like, why is Serge Ibaka? Why is he not playing for the Bucks? Because he's 55.
Yeah.
Like, he went from like blocking shots to shooting threes in like 3 years. He's gonna be like 28, bro. Who are you talking about?
Or Jonathan Kuminga.
He got Grizzlies fans Twitter, bro. Watch yourself, bro.
Yeah, he went at it, huh? He said, whoop that trick or whatever.
Yeah, whoop that, yeah.
He's also 25 years old.
Yeah.
Right, what do you got, Roser?
No, I was just going to update you on the, you mentioned the Cash Me Outside girl. She's 19 years old now.
Oh.
Okay. Danielle Bergoldi, and she is working on her debut album. Yeah.
Oh. What's it called, Roser?
I think I might follow her on Instagram.
The first single is already out. It is called Misunderstood.
Oh.
She said, Roser, and I quote, I made $50 million, so don't call me the Cash Me Outside girl anymore.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Her last,
I didn't know she had a real name.
She has put out two songs, Misunderstood and Bipolar, in 2021.
Oh. She put out those
songs. Yeah, her very first song was These Ho and Hi Bitch.
Wait, These Ho?
Yeah, H-E-A.
Oh, like, oh, okay. She's probably talking about, like, her like these shoes or something.
Gardening?
No. She's talking about, like, her shoes or something, right?
But, she has two songs that are platinum.
Platinum?
Excuse me?
Hi Bitch, B-I-C-H, B-I-C-H, and...
Hi, like H-I or H-I-G-H?
And H-I. Okay. And Gucci Flip Flops featuring Lil Yachty.
Oh, I know that song. Gucci Flip Flops.
Bro, she's got songs with Kodak Black, Megan Thee Stallion, Tory Lanez, Lil Baby, Ty Dolla $ign, NLE Choppa. I'm like, what in the world?
Yeah, she made $50 million.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, do you watch anything, Roser?
No.
Those music videos.
Devin?
I've kind of been, I realized all the old Fresh Prince episodes are on HBO Max, so I've kind of started watching a few of the Fresh Prince or whatever.
Yeah,
I've seen it in a while. That show's still, it's freaking great.
I watched, after we lost the game, I was really sad, so I watched a little bit of Jamie Foxx show, then I watched a little bit of To Catch a Predator on YouTube.
I used to love To Catch a Predator.
I found
some like old archive episodes on YouTube, and I'll start watching.
What's it gonna do?
That
anything?
Made you feel better?
I don't know. It just made me laugh. You know how you like you go on YouTube, you just start scrolling, and then because I've like looked up hilarious like the funny clips from before, so it came up on my recommended again. Mm. So I was like, you know what?
It comes up like, hey, you might want to watch this next.
Yeah, you might want to watch this again. So I watch it.
Was it going to do anything? And it's like, why do you have a freaking... you've got a tall boy of Mike's Hard Lemonade and condoms in a bag. Like, so, like, what is your problem
to
here?
Give her a present.
So, I watched those two things. Not too crazy.
Take a seat.
Yeah.
Number 7, Grant Gunnell, my guy. Well, he's going to North Texas. You know, when he first... entered the transfer portal. That is the one school that I did bring up when we talked about it. I said, I know he's going to talk to North Texas, and I guess he talked to North Texas and got that deal done quick. I wish Grant the best. I will tell you that, as you know, I helped produce the show with him and Preston Brady last year, and I love both of them dearly. They were great.
That show was fun.
He is a great dude, like truly a great dude, and he's a hell of a quarterback, and I do think that Memphis is going to regret it. I do.
They're going to regret it on September 14th.
I can't believe they're playing
Memphis. When North Texas comes to Memphis and faces the Tigers.
They really are. North Texas is coming to face the Tigers. And so I hope Grant achieves everything he wanted to, which was, you know, he's going to come to Memphis and he's going to try to become an NFL quarterback, just like when he went to Arizona. I mean, he's got the size, and we haven't gotten to see him play. He showed out in the spring game. I talked to two different people that told me, like, he's clearly the best quarterback on the roster, but they've already, you know, they've got Seth there. Seth had a really good year, and Grant, for one reason or another, did not think he was going to have the opportunity to start at Memphis. And Seth started as a true freshman, so, right, coming back the next year. And so it's like, all right, I got to – it's totally understandable for him to transfer. I just hope he can – get done what he wants to get done at North Texas, which is have a great year and have an opportunity to maybe get drafted into the NFL. Because he's a great dude.
Great dude.
And tore his Achilles. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we had done the deal with him. And he not only did he, you know, he was self-deprecating. And I saw, now I have the insight into how guys talked about him and then also how they reacted around him. And it was very fascinating to watch. He is a quarterback. There's no way around it.
Yeah.
Like, he's got that thing that we did not feel necessarily when we were around Seth off the field.
Yeah.
And guys just constantly, like, goofed about the Seth thing.
Yeah.
They really did. Like, even on the show, they would goof about it, you know?
Yeah.
Like the linemen, when they would talk about it, whatever. And the other thing was, Grant threw to Calvin Austin at his pro day, which was strange. I mean, I just hope they don't regret this greatly.
Yeah, me either.
And, you know, they brought him here to be the starter.
Yeah.
That's why they brought him here, right? And he kid tore his Achilles. And obviously did not feel – he showed out in the spring game and did not feel like he was going to have a chance to start. So, trust me, I'm going to be rooting for North Texas all season long. I will.
Except when they play Memphis.
I'm going to be rooting – I hope he has a great game.
Yeah, have a good game, Grant, but the Tigers win by a field goal.
But I – North Texas. Yeah, I guess I got to root for him. Well, they're mean green, right?
You're the mean green, bro.
I'm with that. Yeah, I like mean green. Yeah. I like mean green. Yeah,
you talk about.
I'm not going to get merch. He better send me some.
Yeah, I know, right? Send us all some merch, Grant.
He got to get you some merch.
And Preston better send us Florida State.
I was going to say, shout out to Preston for being one of the guys at Florida State. Now, he was a part of that show, too. So we got to find some new guys to do our show.
Yeah, right.
So, yeah, shout out to those two guys. Good dudes.
Number 8. $100 million for Jack Nicklaus. Jack Nicklaus, who is like 87 years old, said he was offered $100 million by that Saudi Golf League to, like, be the face of the Saudi Golf League. Probably like what they've gotten Greg Norman to do.
Yeah.
And he was like, I helped create the PGA Tour. I'm not going to do it. $100 million? Bro. I mean, Jack Nicklaus doesn't need $100 million, right? Yeah. But yeah, I guess it's fair to say, like, hey, who doesn't need $100 million? I mean, $100 million. These guys are throwing around crazy money.
He's 82 years old, bro.
82? I said 87. Okay.
You gave him 5 more years, but he's 82. Yeah. He still play?
Yeah. I mean, he gets around. He plays the senior tees.
The senior tees.
Yeah. But so, $100 million, and obviously there's no. This week is going to be the PGA Championship. It's at Southern Hills in Tulsa. And no Phil Mickelson. And it was all weird because over the weekend the story came out. He's not going to be participating in it. They would have let him, like, he was available. But the reason that's so significant is not just that, are we ever going to see Phil Mickelson on the tour again? He won the PGA Championship last year. So he's not going to defend the championship, right? Mm-hmm. Like, that was a crazy thing to win it at his age, where he's eligible for the senior tour also, and yet he goes and wins the PGA Championship last year. And so you figured if there was one, he would at least go defend his title at the PGA Championship. But he's not playing in it. It is this week, and it sets up to be very, very, very good. Speaking of old guys, number nine. While we were at FedEx Forum on Friday night.
What'd you do?
I darted in to watch The Who.
You watched The Who, bro?
Yo.
Ooh,
hey. The fact that they were, they're like 78 and 76.
Dang.
No. The lead singer and Pete Townsend, Roger Daltrey, the lead singer, and the guitarist. I walked in, you know, this is before our game's going on.
Yeah.
At 9 o'clock. And so they had obviously started at whatever, 8 or whatever. So I was down here. I walked up here, and then I walked over to the arena, and I walked in, and I was like, oh, this is awesome. Like, they sounded incredible. I couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
These guys are older than my dad.
Yeah.
And I was like, how, bro? How are you still rocking? Shocking. This is crazy. These guys are almost 80 years old, and they were going. I'm talking the Daltrey, the lead singer, sounded so damn good.
Are they like dancing? Like, do they like dance to it?
Nah,
like
they don't really dance around.
No, they're rock and roll. They're like
stand there.
Yeah,
and
yeah, okay, yeah. Okay, okay, cool. But and then they had this full on band, and they had like orchestra type people in the background. Like, it was great. It was great. They play, you know, they got mega hits.
Did you get to hear any of like the big songs?
Yeah. Oh yeah. I posted one. Bob O'Reilly. You know,
that was the last
game
of the night.
Wasteland.
That was the last one of the night.
Huh?
That was the last one of the night.
Oh, it was?
Yeah, that was the
Teenage
last
Wasteland
one.
Was? Yeah. So I saw that. I saw the...
They did Love Rain Over Me right before that. That's my favorite Who song.
Were you there, Roger?
No.
No, but I just getting to dart in and see them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I was like, I can't believe these guys sound this good. I really can't. I can't believe it. 78 and 76.
That's pretty impressive.
To be playing full-on shows and sounding like... He can really sing the songs.
Yeah.
He can really still sing those songs. And you know how many stories and hard living they had to have done? Bro, they came up in the 60s.
Oh, yeah.
The British invasion, all that stuff. I mean.
They were all doing drugs.
Wild.
Yeah.
Wild to be that age and still, like, on stage putting on real shows.
Mm-hmm.
And people that were there, like, obviously, I was just darting in and out every time I get a chance. Go catch another song here and there. And I was like, man, I mean, I'd say probably, you know, it was one of those where they basically like from about halfway down the club and then the upper decks, like kind of off. I'd say $5,000.
Okay.
They do about that, and they've been doing about that everywhere. Yeah. Like, and it's not like Memphis was like a bad crowd, very bad crowd compared to. Like, I don't think ticket-wise, it's going crazy.
Were people, like, into it, though? Like,
hell yeah, they were into it.
I'm assuming it was older people.
Yeah, it was older people.
But they were vibing.
Yes.
I saw one, actually, because I was leaving, coming, I don't know, whatever. I was over here, and right before, there was, like, this whole car that was painted, like, the Who style.
Oh,
I don't
that's
know, like,
cool.
Yeah, they drove by, and
like
I was like.
Fans just, like, drove in for it.
They must have, because you don't just have that laying around.
No way.
I guess this concert season, we got to find some stuff to do now, bro.
Well, I don't know if you read this, but I didn't even think about this. I should have mentioned this in the Grant one. So, and it happened when we were away, but that whole Liberty Bowl renovation thing is crazy.
Yeah.
And did you read the article this morning? I didn't even think
it's
about
for
this.
It's for concerts, but it's part of the big upgrades, so they can start having
all
stadium
the people
shows.
That do stadium concerts will then... It now, like, the Liberty Bowl would actually be a place that they would stop off.
So we could get some bigger artists.
Big
artists.
Those are the biggest.
Yeah.
That's what Taylor Swift does. That's what Ed Sheeran does. That's what, who else does that?
A ton of them do it. Guns N' Roses does
Bieber.
Them. Yeah, Bieber. Bieber does arenas, too.
He does.
Yeah, he does stadiums.
But they having a stadium that you can have concerts, that's huge. Because I would say this.
Maybe wrestling events, too, right? Like I'm talking like
Mania.
A SummerSlam or something.
Get a Mania down here. But
SummerSlam's in Nashville.
I don't think
Memphis is ever getting a WrestleMania, but,
What's the date on it?
It's July. The end of July.
Crap.
SummerSlam. Dang. Why? You got something at the end of July?
When is Summer League?
The beginning of July.
It's like the 10th.
Twitter conference. 7th or something.
It's like the 7th through the 17th.
Mm-hmm. I have a Twitter conference.
A
Twitter conference.
Oh, what?
Yeah, dude. Don't call me a nerd.
This is awesome.
Nerd.
SummerSlam?
I have a Twitter conference.
Shut up, nerd.
Twitter conference.
You got a Twitter conference.
No. SummerSlam is July 30th.
Dad knew when he said it, too.
Yeah, I have a Twitter conference.
Shut up, nerd.
SummerSlam's July 30th on a Saturday. Kendrick Lamar's the next day in Nashville, too.
Bro, screw that, by the way, bro. We never get anybody good.
Is that true?
Yeah.
What's he playing that?
Twitter conference.
Is that right?
Yeah. July 31st is Kendrick on a Sunday, yeah.
What a weekend.
Yeah.
We don't get anybody.
SummerSlam Saturday.
Tyler did Nashville.
Kendrick. We just got the
We got Gotti having his birthday bash in July.
No, it's because Nashville has money. Huh? Yeah, Nashville's got more money than us.
Yeah, we got Kurt Franklin in the freaking background.
Hey, man, New Edition was lit. Yeah, we got that Madea show last year.
Which, by the way, they had to add like two more because the freaking sold out so fast.
Bro, our next shows, bro, look. Okay,
FedEx Forum. Our concert slate is not a good one.
Our next
right
coming
now.
Shows on FedEx Forum. Cheer Live, which
what the
got
hell
canceled.
Is that? Oh, we got canceled.
The Kingdom Tour, Maverick City Music featuring Kurt Franklin, Yo Gotti and Friends Birthday Bash. In Backstreet Boys DNA World Tour.
No, Backstreet Boys.
That's Backstreet.
That's
ready. All right.
What the hell are we doing?
What do you mean, what the hell are we doing?
Backstreet got Kendrick, Tyler, Future, Baby, and the Baby Tour is going to Nashville.
Yeah, let's.
We got to buy tickets when people come here, you know what I mean?
Man, that's lame.
Yeah, they are. Man, this is this week at Bridgestone.
Bro, don't throw us a stop, bro.
Justin Bieber on Wednesday. Saturday, Love Kid Rock and Jason Bonham's Led Zeppelin experience.
What the hell?
Brooks and Dunn the week after. Dude Perfect. Rod Stewart, One Republic, Kendrick Lamar, Kevin Hart, Wiz Khalifa and Logic, Michael Bublé. Dierks Bentley, Roger Waters, 21 Pilots. Yeah, I mean, it's...
Yeah, screw all those other ones, bro. We don't need all of them.
My Chemical Romance.
We couldn't schedule anything for a while because we thought we might be at all the way to the final.
Yeah, they got
to schedule all that because they're sorry-ass hockey team. By the way, St. Louis Blues playing against the Colorado Avalanche. Screw Colorado.
Oh.
And by the way, I own Minnesota. I own Minnesota. I might as well have a house in Minnesota after the St. Louis Blues dismantled them as an underdog after the Grizzlies had already destroyed them in round one. I own Minnesota. I own it.
You own Minnesota. You should update the Wikipedia page.
Yeah.
Owned by Chris Vernon. Like the whole state?
That's right.
It's mine.
I own you now.
Yeah.
Number 10 tonight. We don't really have anything. I mean, we got the NBA because of the Game 7s that took place yesterday, there's a little time off, so we don't have...
There's not even WNBA games tonight.
No, we don't have an NBA game that is going on tonight. We got some LB's Bowl that is going to be going on.
Kelsey will watch something where somebody gets murdered.
Jacob Blevins just slacked me and said, go watch Run on Hulu. It's the same type of thing as...
And how about this? So. This other weird thing. So I just mentioned the Blues are playing the Colorado Avalanche. That's not until tomorrow. And the Lightning and the Florida Panthers, that other NHL series, that's not until tomorrow. So there's nothing.
So there's nothing to watch.
There's no NHL. There's no NBA. Like, we're in a weird spot. It's just baseball's on. That's it.
I guess I watched Monday Night Raw. I watched like old Pat Bev clips from this morning. Watch those joints on loop.
Pat Bev was unbelievable.
Talk
in the first
about
take.
Murder documentaries.
He was like a wrestler, bro. He was like a wrestler.
It was amazing. It was amazing.
So
if there was ever
so
a better
to be that angry.
Yeah, the best. Honestly, like the absolute best guest you could possibly have the day after the Phoenix Suns vomited all over themselves. Is Pat Bev, who just hates him. And you know what he is? You know this, Dev. This is... I mean, there's seven guys like that at every barbershop or convenience store in Memphis. He is that guy that... some of what he says is just absolute nonsense, but he is so damn confident saying it.
Is it believable?
Yes.
You're like, you know what?
He's like, Chris Paul's a traffic cone. You know what I mean? Like,
you called him a
Stephen A. You're like, wait, does he suck at defense?
You know those things.
I never really thought about it that much.
Stephen A's like a cone? He's like, yeah, a cone. You know, like the thing you like do drills in? I
was
like,
cone.
Damn.
We call those pylons, by the way.
He was smashing them.
Then Paul George called. He was like,
He said we wanted to play them to Minnesota. That's so great.
I was talking to one of my old teammates. I ain't gonna say his name. You know what? I'm gonna say his name. Paul George. I'm like,
I talked to Paul George last night. Oh, the one moment on that show where I was like, oh my God, no, Molly, no. She went to a break. I'm like, if you got to blow through the break, you blow through the break. Because they were talking at one point. His hot, like, he was just hot take spewing the whole time for 2 hours.
Which is gold.
Everything he said was like some kind of, you're like, what? Everything.
He is in the barbershop, bro.
The one time she went to the break, she was like, all right, we'll get back to that. We got to go to the break, whatever. He was like, I was like, No. I don't care what you have planned. I don't care what break you got to go do. You have got to let him expound on this. He was like, oh, well, everybody knows what happened at the bubble don't matter. And she's like, all right, we got to go to a break. And I'm like, no! I have got to hear him defend the fact that the bubble doesn't count. He said the bubble doesn't count.
Dude, that's, he was trash.
The bubble doesn't count. That's what he said.
He was defending James Harden. I was like, bro, he was crapping on Grayson Allen.
About bad defenders and then defending James Harden.
Yeah.
Bro, he was wild.
He said the bubble doesn't count.
I'm kind of with him on that.
They're going to have him on every network.
But I'm saying that was like an awesome, like, wait, what? And then they were like, oh, we got to go to break. I was like, no, I got to hear this. Why the bubble didn't count?
You know he's gonna be on every network. Yeah, now,
he'll
right?
be back. Oh, he just got hired.
Yeah,
like TNT he got hired gone. Off of that. He got hired.
Him and Draymond will have a show together.
He's wild.
Called Loud Mouse.
I'd watch it.
He's wild. Like wild.
Yeah, he's like a bad guy wrestler. He like woke up this morning, like put his t-shirt on. Like, yeah, I'm ready to go start some Instagram.
No, I mean, what timing?
After another t-shirt.
What timing? After
you think
that?
He was playing?
He hates Chris Paul and Devin Booker. Remember he hates them.
He tweeted before Chris Paul said that he was like, somebody's going to fake an injury. Just wait. And then Chris Paul this morning, Mark Spears tweeted, Chris Paul was playing with a quad injury.
Of course.
And he was like, I told y'all. Like, bro.
Last year it was a hand. This year it's a quad. It's always something.
He's hurt always in the playoffs.
It's always something. Yeah.
Sorry, Chris Paul. Hey, you didn't mention, I know we got to go, but you didn't mention the Jimmy Butler thing. You chose Tobias over me.
Oh
my God.
You chose Tobias over me.
I love Jimmy Butler so damn much.
I love Jimmy Butler too. I do.
Even Joel Embiid sitting up there talking about how much
he misses him.
Well, how we didn't hold on to this guy.
He chose Tobias Harris and Ben Simmons over me. He ain't forget. I love you, Jimmy Butler.
No, he's so petty, and that's what's so great about him.
Ultra. Mm-hmm. It's going to do it for today's show. Thank you to Kelsey Wright Johnson. Thanks to Devin Walker. Thanks to John Roser across the glass. Thanks to Kimball back in the studio. Until tomorrow, we go.